yes, it actually happened. After having flown 250 million kilometers through the solar system and taking nearly 10 months to do so, Phoenix finally landed on the 25th of May, 2008, exactly where it was planned to do so, in the northern polar region. Here, there's water in the form of ice under the surface, and now researchers can begin to investigate the habitability of the planet. Could there be life on Mars? The University of Arizona in Tucson is one of the leading universities in the US within the field of planetary science. The Lunar and Planetary Laboratory in the Department of Planetary Sciences studies the formation and evolution of our planetary system. The department has been involved in all US Mars missions, and it's from here, the University of Arizona, that the Phoenix Mars mission is run. The landing went perfectly. And after only 2 hours, the first images start streaming down to Earth. So the researchers are busy right from the start.
I didn't run out sequence som Phoenix fik i går. Der var der besked om at den skulle tage tre billeder over hinanden, som er en del af det der hedder mission success panorama. Og de billeder, det bliver farvebilleder. Det vil sige, de bliver taget gennem hvert af de tre billeder bliver taget gennem tre forskellige filtre, så man af de sort-hvide billeder der kommer ned kan lave farvebilleder. Og når man laver farvebilleder, så skal de bruge de danske farvekalibreringstargets til at få farverne rigtige. Så vi glæder os til at se de første farvebilleder, eller de første billeder af vores kalibreringstargets, der gør, at vi kan lave dem i noget, der ligner naturlige farver.
Three Danish instruments, KAL targets, located on the deck of the lander, will be used to study the magnetic properties of the airborne dust, as well as to adjust the colors in the camera. The camera can only take black and white images. It takes a series of images of the same motif, but through different color filters. A red filter, then a green filter, and a blue filter, and the three images are combined. The colors are adjusted based on the colors of the KAL targets. This means that the colors in the landscape are truly natural. Data from the experiments the lander has conducted are sent up to one of the two satellites orbiting Mars. From here, they're sent back to Earth, where they're received in Tucson. The data signals from the satellite are called downlinks. There's always a little celebration when data is received. The press is kept informed by Peter Smith, the mission's principal investigator.
This is our first look at the surface. We've only looked at one tiny little slit.
The most important things to check with the first images are that the camera is working, that the lander is stable, and that the solar panels providing the power supply have unfurled. The images are astoundingly good. The KAL targets have already proven to be invaluable. They were developed by the Danish researchers taking part in the mission.
Over the years, we've found that some of the best scientists and technologists in the world are in other countries. So of course we want to do the best science we can, and we've gone to Germany, to Denmark, to Switzerland and to Finland and other countries that we have great technology, and of course one of our major partners is Canada. And when it comes to magnets, which is of course Mars is a very magnetic place, we want to get the best, and Denmark has the Niels Bohr Institute, which is by far the number one place in the world for doing magnetic studies. So that's where we go.
The researchers are working with their data. There are always exciting new results to keep up with.
Want to go see it? They have it on the screen in the SSI room.
Let's go see it.
We'll be back here.
Yeah.
Here you are.
How's that look? Look good?
Yeah,
looks pretty good.
This is great.
So you can see all the Kapton-wrapped cables. This is the material we used for the telltale.
Uh-huh.
And these are the fiducial targets.
Yeah.
They look quite good.
The researchers work all hours of the day, so blue light is essential to give an impression of daylight. Lene Drube is a PhD student in the Danish Mars group. She's just about to download the latest images of the calibration targets to her computer.
Vi skal sidde og finde ud af, for eksempel de billeder, vi fik i går af calibration targets. Dem var der nogle underlige ting på, altså der var en stor støvpartikler på, og nu vil vi få dem snart i forskellige farver, sådan så vi rent faktisk kan se mere om, hvilken type støvpartikler det er, fordi de ser ud til at være magnetiske. Så det bliver meget interessant for at finde ud af, om det var, vi regner med, det var en del af landingen, hvor at de fik det oven på, på selve vores instrumenter. Men man kan se, at de har været magnetiske, så det vil være interessant at se, hvilken type materiale det er.
It's these large clumps that surprise the researchers. The dust in the air is magnetic, but it's also very fine. These clumps are so large, they must come from underneath the surface. So what can the analysis tell us about the soil on Mars? Are there minerals that can sustain life? There are also fresh images of another instrument that the Danish Mars group has on the Phoenix mission.
Nå, det er taltalen. Det er den her instrument, som sitter på toppen af det meteorologiske mast. Og det viser jo, når vinden blæser, at så deflekter den her kapterndel. Og det er nøjagtigt det, som vi ser på overfladen af Mars.
The telltale is a wind gauge. It was specially developed and designed for the conditions on Mars, where the air pressure is less than 1% of that of the Earth. This means that the instrument needs to be extremely sensitive. The wind gauge appears to be very simple, a short tube weighing only 3 milligrams on a string. But it is ingenious and can show both wind speed and direction in great detail. The camera takes images of the wind gauge through 2 different filters. The blue filter takes images with a long exposure time. This means that when the telltale vibrates in the wind, images are blurred. This gives a measurement of turbulence in the wind. The red filter takes sharp images. This shows the current wind direction at the moment the image is taken.
So, how much do you think the wind is?
Information is pouring down from Mars, and it's data of a very high quality, which they must now set about analyzing.
Når vi ser på teltalen, så kigger vi mod syd vest.
Let me introduce you to today's participants.
It's now the third day of the mission. And the orientation at the press meeting is also characterized by an uplifted mood.
And joining us from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, NASA's own Superman, Barry Goldstein, the Phoenix Project Manager.
Let me start by saying the spacecraft is in excellent health, absolutely excellent health, and I know we had a bit of drama here yesterday.
The drama was due to a situation where there was no contact with the satellite that was supposed to send the radio signals between the lander on Mars and control center on Earth. But despite the temporary interruption in radio contact, the lander has had enough instructions to perform a series of tasks. And this has resulted in exceptionally good images of the horizon around the lander.
Our initial plan was to get the entire landing site at low resolution in black and white and then come back and take it at higher resolution in color and get to that as soon as we can. Turns out with the run out, we actually got a head start on the color part. When we take color images with SSI, one thing we'd like to do is make sure we're showing you the right color. So we actually fly little color calibration targets on the lander. This is an example of one, an engineering model that we have on the Earth. These were provided by the University of Copenhagen in Denmark.
It's teeming with images of the Mars landscape as far as the eye can see, and all the way around the lander. And instead of referring to areas as numbers and degrees, areas are given names. The theme is fairy tales. An image is also taken from underneath the lander, which shows something that could be ice. Holy cow, somebody remarked. Hence, the place came to be called Holy Cow. Mars is a desert planet, rocky, dusty, barren. Can a desert on Mars be compared with a desert on Earth?
Her sidder vi i en ørken på jorden, lige omkring Tucson, hvor kontrolcenteret for Phoenix-missionen er. Og det, man kan se, når man kigger omkring os her, det er, at det vrimler simpelthen med biologi overalt. Den ørken, vi studerer på Mars, er anderledes. Når vi kigger omkring os på Mars, så kan vi ikke se bare antydning af biologi nogen steder. Og det skyldes blandt andet, at atmosfæren er så tynd på Mars, så sollyset det brænder hele vejen ned til overfladen med kraftig UV-stråling, og det steriliserer de øverste overfladelag. Så hvis vi skal finde spor af biologi eller mulighed for biologi på Mars, så skal vi grave mindst 10 cm ned under jorden. Vi regner faktisk med, at vi skal, i hvert fald i det ekvatoriale egne, der skal vi nogle meter ned, eller mindst en meter ned. Men lige præcis her, hvor Phoenix er landet, der er der måske mulighed for at finde et område mellem jorden og isen, der ligger nede i permafrosten, hvor de bedste betingelser for biologi vil være.
So, it's not the prickly cacti or scurrying lizards of the Arizona desert you will find on Mars. But just below the surface, there could be traces of life. Life in the form of microorganisms. Here, researchers will dig down with the robot arm and take samples of the soil. Just 1 week after the landing, the robot lifts its very first spoonful of Martian soil. Two shovels down, a white layer appears in the wall of the trench. This gives rise to heated discussions over whether it could be salt or ice, or something else entirely. Concentrations of salt can indicate that it's previously been wet. And one of the aims of the mission is to determine whether the ice underneath the surface ever thawed during changing climatic periods. If there could be flowing water, then perhaps there could be life. Life that goes into hibernation for periods, then wakes up again. 1 week later, the Mars lander is digging up its first shovelful of Martian soil, which will be examined by an instrument on the lander's deck. The instrument, called TIGA, is a mini laboratory which sniffs out and analyzes the Martian atmosphere and makes a mass spectrometric analysis of minerals and water content. But it doesn't go very well. The soil is clumping and will not fall through the small opening into the TIGA instrument. They consider different strategies for the next sampling, so as to shake the sample to loosen clumps before it's poured into the oven. Meanwhile, data's coming down from the telltale. The images show the wind gauge in calm weather, in windy weather, and in a dust hurricane, or dust devils, as the researchers call them. And they're also looking at more than just the wind gauge.
Vi sidder og kigger på temperatur- og trykmålinger fra meteorologimasten. Vi kigger på det her, fordi man kan se fald i tryk og i temperatur viser, hvis der nu for eksempel kommer en dust devil, en støvhvirvel forbi. Og det er så det, vi prøver at sidde og kigge på, når vi har fået de første 2 dages målinger. Som faktisk er ret interessant at se på, fordi man kan se, at der er et voldsomt dyk i trykket, som så fortæller os, at der skulle meget gerne have kommet sådan en dust devil forbi. Og det, vi så håber på, er selvfølgelig længden at kunne se, hvis nu der er et bestemt tid på dagen, hvor de kommer, så kunne fange dem med kameraet og kunne se, at der måske er en sammenhæng mellem solens højde, temperaturdykkene, hvornår de kommer, hvor de kommer.
Why and how? This is precisely what drives research. Investigate and understand. Researchers are like detectives trying to find answers to all of the mysteries of the universe. Such as the mystery of Mars. Perhaps they'll find the answer in the coming months of the Phoenix Mars mission.